Okay, good afternoon and welcome everyone. It's 15, so here in Milan, 9 in EST time. Thank you all for being here. So let's start officially this webinar. I am really very happy, very glad to host Professor Galit Shmueli of Tsinghua University. She will give us a talk in a few seconds. Before starting the webinar, however, let me just recall briefly, especially for the members, our DAS agenda of these next days that is really very dense. On October 20th, that is 15 days from now, we will have a free of access, open access, the finalist presentation for the DAS Practice Award. Here, I really thank Valentina Ferretti, Gilberto Montibellet, and Nadia Papamichael for their great work. On October 24th, during the INFORMS meeting, we will have the Peter Fishburne Memorial Panel. As you know, Peter Fishburne, who was a giant of decision analysis, unfortunately and sadly passed away this June, actually on June 10th, 2021. And this is the first event organized by the Society to bring up the memory of Peter and describe his several contributions to decision analysis. The panel will be on Sunday, October 24th at 7:45 a.m. Pacific time. I really want to thank Robin Keller and all the speakers for making this really an unforgettable event. On October 15th, we will have the DAS business meeting. This is a very important event for the society. You know, it's a moment of the year where we present everything that has been going on during the past year and also the plans for the future. And there are several novelties I would like to share with all the members. So October 25th, 12 Pacific time, which is more or less, I think 9 in Europe, should be around 15 EST. On October 26th, we will have the DAS Award session. The time is not fixed yet, but this is another sort of central moment for the society. And just an announcement, the ADA 2022 conference will be on June 22-24, 2022 in Washington. And I really would like to thank Yale, Grushka Cocaine, and Manel Bausels for all their efforts in organizing this very important event for the society, which is the Advancing Decision Analysis Conference. So now we remember to renew your membership. And now we go to the webinar. Professor Galit Shmueli, whom you see is already there. I really wish to thank her for several reasons. First, for accepting our invitation. And second, for being willing to give this webinar at a time which for her is not really comfortable because it's more or less 9 in the evening. So really, double thank Galit for accepting our invitation. Professor Shmueli is a Tsinghua Distinguished Professor and Institute Director at the Institute of Service Science, College of Technology Management of National Tsinghua University in Taiwan. Professor Shmueli's research focuses on data science, let's say at large. She has a very influential paper in 2010 on statistical science, To Explain or to Predict, that received more than 2,000 citations. Her book, Data Mining for Business Analytics, is a bestseller. And she has more than 100 scientific papers in several prestigious journals. Professor Shmueli's scientific interests are, again, business analytics, data mining, prediction, and also at the interface, I might say, with business analytics and decision analysis also. She's the current editor-in-chief, and I think it's the first inaugural editor-in-chief of the Informed Journal on Data Science. And we know now we are in the digital era epoch. We know that there is a lot of intersection also between interest and support of decision analysis made by machine learning, inference, and prediction. So whom to talk to us about how these two fields can you know, entangle and where they can overlap than Professor Shmueli. So thank you very much, Galit. I leave the floor to you and also stop sharing my screen. And thank you for your talk and time.
Hey, wonderful. Thank you so much for this very nice introduction, Emanuele, and thank you for the invitation. As I mentioned, this is a second. Sorry, this is the wrong one. Next.
moment.
Okay, this should be the right one. No. You're seeing my entire desktop, right?
We are seeing Galita started screen sharing. Double click to enter full screen mode.
Okay, one second. Let me stop again.
It worked before, I can assure everyone.
Yeah, I know. We're going to try and make it work again. Let me see.
Thank you. Now it's there.
Second. Okay. Wonderful. So I think now you should be able to see the slides. So again, thank you very much for the invitation. This is a very interesting experience for me, because I don't think that I know a few of the people in the decision analysis community, definitely Yael Grushka-Cocaine and Casey Lichtendahl. But I'd be very curious to hear your reactions to this talk, because again, I don't know too much about how this interfaces with the kind of work that you do, but I'm sure that it's relevant because I know that you also deal with forecasting. So the work is called How to Improve. And the trick here is to look at the improve, seeing that it's in quotes, because I'm not really going to be introducing a new prediction algorithm, but I'm going to show you a strategy that appears to be improving predictions. And by this appearance is creating some very interesting problems. This is joint work with Ali Tafti at UIC. And let me just dive right into it. So many of you probably heard of Yuval Noah Harari, the famous historian who's written some books such as Sapiens or Homo Deus. And he gave an interesting interview at TED where he said the following. He said, the ability to hack human beings means the ability to understand humans better than they understand themselves, which means being able to predict their choices, to manipulate their emotions, and to make decisions for them. And this is really the background to the kind of talk and data that I'll be talking about and decision-making that I'll be talking about in this talk. So I'm gonna start with some background. I'm gonna talk about how digital platforms, and when I talk about digital platforms, I'm talking about anything, you know, Google, Facebook, any of the big platforms. And I'll talk about how they predict user behavior. And then I'll also talk about how these same digital platforms have the capability to modify user behavior. And after this background, I'll introduce my work, which is what happens when a digital platform has the capability to do both, predict and modify user behavior, and how they can use this to combine this to quote unquote, improve predictions. And I'll give you a few scenarios. They might be imaginary, but they might not be imaginary. And then I'll show you that in order to analyze these scenarios and figure out what's going on, I actually needed to introduce some new notation, because the current notation that we have is insufficient. Using this notation, I'm able to analyze what's called the expected prediction error. And after I do this, this actually makes a few very interesting and alarming discoveries and insights pop up. So I'm going to hopefully share with you this whole framework within the next 45 or 50 minutes. Okay, so I'm going to start with digital platforms predicting user behavior. And I'm sure most of you already know this, but behavioral big data, what I call BBD, is a combination of big data and behavioral data. Big data, many of us know, whatever field you're in, usually relates to data sets that have many records that sometimes come from multiple sources. The data are very rich. There's a lot of detailed information at the micro level. And now we're talking about humans and behavioral data. And there I'm talking about people's measurable actions, reactions, interactions, as well as self-reported opinions, their thoughts, their feelings. When you put these two things together, you get what's called behavioral big data. And these kinds of behavioral big data have been around for a long time. It's not new. Traditional companies such as banks, supermarkets, insurance companies, governments, they've had behavioral big data for a very long time. And many of these have used it for predicting our future behavior. So if you think about credit cards, right, they use the behavioral data to determine premiums. Insurance companies do that as well. But now what's new is that these same institutions have a lot more richer data and new kinds of behavioral big data that they did not have before. So for example, if you think about IoT or smart home devices, such as, let's say, smart thermostats that measure and know when people are coming in, who's in which room, when they're leaving on holidays, what they like. Now you have a lot more behavioral rich micro level data about them. If you go even closer to your body, we have in the cars now, many insurance companies ask you to plug in a little gizmo that records not only where you're driving, but it's recording how you're driving. Maybe you're braking too fast, or you're taking, when you're driving right or left, you're going too fast. So these devices are measuring information about how we are actually behaving or driving. We have now smart wearables. So if you think about anything like these types of shoes, they know again, not only where we're going, but maybe if we're running with our partner or with other friends, they know who's running together to what areas. Of course, if we're wearing any of the smart watches or fitness bands, those know a lot about us, when we're sleeping, what else we're doing, even how much email is coming in, when we have meetings. So there's a lot of behavioral data that's being captured by these gadgets that we're wearing. And we know that even children now are playing with smart toys, and these smart toys record anything from the text that the voice that the children are talking to the toys, and even maybe other adults around or other playmates that are there. So there's a lot of new kinds of behavioral big data that traditional companies collect and use for predicting future behaviors. Why do they do this? Well, they want to predict our behaviors so that they can personalize these products and services, so that they can improve them. Some of them use it for fraud detection. We know some of them use it for advertising, for marketing, for logistics and operations. But what I'm going to tell you today is not really about these traditional companies. Today, I'm going to focus more on these digital platforms. And digital platforms are the kind of the new kid on the block, although we all know this has been going on for the last 5-10 years. And they also use behavioral data. So if you're using any kind of device like the ones that you see here on my slide, whether it's a laptop or you're listening to this through your mobile phone or an iPad, or you're using any kind of a assistant like an Alexa or something like that, then these are all recording and collecting our behavioral big data. And just like the traditional companies, they use this data, the platforms use this data to predict our future behaviors. When I'm talking about platforms, I'm talking about many, many, many different web and mobile digital platforms. So if you're using any kind of service like Uber or Lyft or Airbnb, for example, or if you're using, of course, any of the social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, if you're using services such as online dating or maybe streaming entertainment like Netflix or Hulu or Amazon, all of these are basically digital platforms that collect a lot of behavioral data and use it to predict our future behavior. Why do they want to predict our behavior? For the exact same reasons that I mentioned before. They want to personalize and improve their products or services. They want to use it for detecting fraud. We know that advertising is the main business goal of several of these. They use it for marketing and they use it for logistics and operations. So predictions are very, very important, and behavioral big data is a major component of what's used to create these predictions. What kind of behaviors do they try to predict? Well, here's some classic ones. They want to predict the probability that we will purchase the service or product. They want to predict the probabilities of churn of people leaving their services. Very important, they want to predict how much time we're spending on their site or on the app. That's called engagement. We know that they can predict emotional states. There have been several papers even talking about the kinds of emotional states that they can predict. They can predict voting behavior, and they can predict lots of different life events, everything from pregnancy to job changes and more. Here's a recent kind of a prediction tool that Google has been selling to its advertisers, and it's called predictive audiences. And you can see that they're selling them predictions of likely 7-day purchasers, so it's the probability that people will purchase, or churning users, and it could be first-time purchasers or whatever it is. So this is an example of the kind of predictions that these platforms want to generate and then use for their customers. Now, as a data scientist, whether you're coming from machine learning or from statistics or some other field, the kind of efforts that we put into improving predictions are the following. We usually will think of, we have a certain set of, we have data on the records, on people or users or whatever it is. And we have, let's say, a lot of information about the user, which I call the user profile, and about the context, the time of day, the location, things like that. And what I want to do is I basically want to predict a certain user behavior. Let's say, what's the chance that they will buy my product? So I will collect a big set of data on this X data, and I have a big set of data on the Y, the observed user behavior. And then I'll build a model, or what's called training a model or estimating a model. This is my predictive model F of X. And now when I have new users and I have their X data, I plug it into my predictive model, and that gives me the predicted user behavior. Now, of course, my predictions are never exactly correct. So I have this distance between the actual behavior and the predicted behavior, and that's what I call the prediction error. And my goal as a data scientist is to try and do all my tricks to reduce prediction error. So how can I do that? One, I can build better algorithms. I can, my F of X, I can create more, you know, better algorithms, better approaches to prediction. And that's what, again, statistics machine learning has been doing for many years. Another approach is to improve the data that you collect. And that's the X and the Y. So the better my data, the better I can estimate these models. So eventually my predictions will be better. And more recently, as you've seen a lot of use of deep learning and computational heavy methods, building or buying or getting better computing infrastructure can also help with prediction efforts. And these are exactly the kinds of efforts that many of these companies do. So if you think about, again, Google or Facebook, they hire and pay very well to data scientists who can improve these kinds of prediction algorithms and prediction approaches. These companies also purchase a lot of other smaller companies so that they get better data. So for example, when Facebook buys Instagram, or when Google bought YouTube, they basically have a lot better data that they can use to generate predictions. And finally, these companies develop their own in-house infrastructure. And many times we as researchers or users, we even buy that infrastructure back. So if you're using Amazon Cloud Services, that's an example. So that was about prediction. At the same time, these digital platforms also have capabilities to manipulate or modify user behavior. And let me tell you a little bit about this. And this is a little bit different from prediction. And my undergrad many, many years ago was, I did a dual degree. It was in statistics and in psychology. And I never knew when psychology would actually turn out to be useful, but it turns out that a lot of the things I learned back then are happening right now. So internet platforms use behavior modification techniques together with this behavioral big data to change users' behaviors. What kind of behaviors are they trying to change? They're trying to modify the probabilities that we purchase. They want to reduce the churn probabilities. They want to increase the time that we stay on the website. They want to manipulate or change our emotions. They can change voting behaviors. And we know that they can also change life events. So these same kinds of events that they're able to predict, they also are interested and are capable of changing. How do they change it? They're using methods called behavior modification. And if you go and look at textbooks about what behavior modification is, here's a dry textbook definition. It's an intervention designed to enhance certainty by altering causal processes that regulate behavior. Very short description, it's modifying behavior in a predictable way so that you know where, in which direction that behavior is going. The other keyword to notice here is that we're talking about altering or regulating behavior in a way that is actually not fully aware. So if you think about what's happening here is we're manipulating the lower brain so that we as humans just react and do things. For example, if you have any apps on your phone and they have notifications on, what's the first thing that happens when a notification turns on or dings or something on your phone? You right away pick up your phone, you look at the phone, you click on the notification. You don't have to think about it. That's what you're supposed to be doing. So that's modifying your behavior in a very predictable way. It will take you exactly to the place that the app designer designed you to go to. Companies have gotten onto this kind of behavior modification, and they use this very heavily. There's a book by Nir Eyal called Hooked, where he explains companies must learn not only what compels users to click, but also what makes them tick. Habits are defined as behaviors done with little or no conscious thought. So you can see that many of the designers of these services are designing their technology to kind of subvert your conscious thought so that you can build habits and behaviors that are predictable. Now, where did all this come from? It came from psychology, from Skinner, if you've heard of the famous B.F. Skinner, who's developed these techniques many years ago to try and modify or shape users or humans' behaviors. It started from animal sciences, and of course, the goal was for changing humans' behaviors to try and help you improve your life. Later on, the behavioral economists have caught on that. So if you've read the book Nudge by Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein, that's what they're doing, where you can basically change policies so that, for example, when you change things from opt-in to opt-out, the whole result is different. That's an example of using behavior modification. And more recently, the human-computer interaction people have caught on to this. And a very famous person in this field is BJ Fogg at Stanford, who has the Persuasive Technologies Lab. And that's where many of the entrepreneurs who then later go and start Silicon Valley apps, they go and learn about these techniques and then implement them into the apps. Now, behaviorist techniques, there's a whole host of them. I'm not going to get into them. You're welcome to go and read about them. There's some very interesting books talking about them. But you might have heard words such as tuning and nudging, where you place subliminal cues in the context, or herding and tunneling. If you've ever gone to Las Vegas, and you might have noticed that at the entrance to some of these places, they actually tunnel you. There's ways and paths with the lighting, with the carpeting and everywhere that leads you exactly to the slot machines, to the place that you're supposed to be ending up. And then there's also a whole world of what's called conditioning or reinforcement schedules. So for example, if I give you rewards on a very certain every minute, you're not really going to change your behavior, but it turns out that random rewards work much better. So there's a whole theory of what works better in changing people's behaviors. So now let me take these two, the prediction and the behavior modification capabilities, and put them together and show you how you can use these two capabilities, if you're a platform, to improve prediction. How did this idea even come to my mind? So I was reading a very interesting book by a social psychologist, Shoshana Zuboff at Harvard. And she wrote this book called The Age of Surveillance Capitalism that came out in 2019. And what she describes there is, this is an image from her book, is how these large platforms collect immense amounts of behavioral big data. And some of it they use for their own usage. So at the bottom here, you see a little piece here, the behavioral data that they use for their service improvements and analytics. But a large amount of it, which she calls surplus, is actually being used in a whole different way. The platforms create what's called prediction products, and then they sell these products in what she calls behavioral futures markets. Now, it's not that Google sells your data to other companies. The data is too valuable for that. But what they do is they package it in a prediction product, like the one I showed you earlier that Google sells, and then they will sell your predictions to advertisers, to insurers, to, it could be governments, whoever would benefit from using these kinds of predictions. So when I was reading this book, it came, you know, I was thinking to myself, first of all, this looks pretty terrible. If any of you have ever seen, you know, the interesting Buddhist samsara wheel, this kind of reminded me of that. But the next thing that came to mind was, I was asking myself, wait a minute, so if predictions are so valuable that they're being sold on these markets, then you really want to invest in these predictions, because more valuable predictions, better predictions give you more valuable prediction products. Now, remember the traditional approaches that, you know, geeks like myself and other data scientists do? We improve the predictive algorithm, we get better data, we get better computing infrastructure. Yeah, the companies are doing all that. But actually, there's one more way I can create prediction products that look super good. And that is by pushing users' behaviors towards their predictions. In other words, I can make users more predictable. So if I'm thinking about this idea, how is this going to work? Let me give you a few scenarios so that you get the idea. I will say these are imaginary so that I don't get any, nobody sues me, but you can decide how imaginary they are. So first, an imaginary scenario. I have a political consulting firm and they want to reach out to people who are likely to vote for candidate A. Now I have an internet platform who wants to sell these prediction products, and they want to sell them predicted scores that are vote for A. So people with high vote for A scores, people with low vote for A scores. How does the internet platform show its predictive power? They'll take a bunch of users, generate these predicted scores for them for vote for A, and then they're going to push these users towards their scores. So users who had very high scores, they're likely to vote for A. They're going to be seeing ads or other content or connecting with friends that are more likely to vote for A. And people who have very low scores to vote for A are going to see content that is going to push them away from voting to A for A. In other words, it's going to actually make everybody more predictable. And in that case, the platform is turning these voting predictions into voting realities. Here's another imaginary scenario. Suppose that we have an insurance company and they want to acquire new customers, but they really want to avoid high-risk customers. So they're going to buy from an internet platform predicted risk scores. And this internet platform, again, wants to showcase their predictive power so that they can charge well and they can compete with other platforms. So they're going to take a bunch of users and generate risk scores for these users. And then they're going to push the users towards their scores. So users that had very risky behavior will see more content that will make them even more riskier. For example, if you're driving, maybe I'm engaging you on your phone. Or if you're at work, maybe I'm showing you some ads for alcohol. Or I can do the other direction for people who have very low risk scores. I can keep them away from risky behaviors. But again, what happens in this example is that the platform again turns these high risk scores into high risk realities. Final third scenario. We've all been living in COVID for a while. So suppose that we have governments that want to identify citizens with high risk of becoming severely ill with COVID. Maybe they want to prioritize them for vaccination or for whatever kinds of services. And now we have a platform that wants to sell the government these COVID susceptibility scores. What is the platform going to do? It's going to grab a bunch of users, estimate or predict some risk scores for them, and then push the users' behaviors towards their scores. So for example, for people who are risky, we might want to encourage them to go to crowded locations. And maybe we want them to connect with other friends that maybe are risky. And the opposite for those who have a low risk. So again, at the end of the day, these high risk scores are turning into high risk realities. And of course, the low risk scores become lower risk. So how does this work? In general, it's a two-step process. And it's important to notice that it's two steps. The first step is you generate predictions the standard way. There's nothing unusual here. You generate predictions, you use your behavioral big data, you use the predictive models that you developed, and you have predictions. The interesting part is what you do with these predictions. Now you use this as input into your second step, and you're going to be pushing the users so that their eventual outcome Y gets closer to their predicted value Y hat. How are you going to do this? We're going to use the platform's behavior modification functionality. So remember what I showed you before of this is the statistical or machine learning approach to building predictive models and improving them. Here's how the behavior modification adds to this. So now I'm going to use the user's mental state and I'm going to manipulate that through behavior modification. So here's the behavior modification researcher and they're going to manipulate the platform behavior so that it modifies the user's mental state, which pushes the user's behavior towards the predicted score, so that we end up with a prediction error in orange that is much smaller than the prediction error in red. And it looks like my predictions are really good. My Y hats ended up being pretty close to the actual Y. Now, many people will say, well, why would a platform do this? Well, I went and searched in other literatures and other fields, and it turns out that this alarm bell has been going on for quite a while. So for example, in media theory, a very famous media theorist by the name of Douglas Rushkoff wrote a book called Team Human. He described a scenario where the better the platform does at making Mary conform to her algorithmically determined destiny, the more the platform can boast both its predictive accuracy and its ability to induce behavior change. In a completely different field, in law, there's a law professor at University of Maryland, Professor Frank Pascoli. And he wrote a book called The Black Box Society. And in an interview that he gave at The Intercept, he said the following. He said, Facebook's behavioral prediction work is eerie, and he worried how the company could turn algorithmic predictions into self-fulfilling prophecies, since once they've made this prediction, they have a financial interest in making it true. Finally, if you go into the field of AI itself, where you have the biggest advocates for this kind of prediction, Stuart Russell, famous computer scientist at Berkeley, wrote a book called Human Compatible, which is pretty interesting. And in it, he describes the following. He says, content selection algorithms on social media are designed to maximize click-through. The solution is simply to present items that the user likes to click on, right? Wrong. The solution is to change the user's preferences so that they become more predictable. So what all these different areas are pointing to is that the platform has financial incentive and the technical capability to actually modify people's behavior towards their predicted scores. Now, are the platforms actually doing this? Well, I don't work for any of the platforms. I don't have any inside information on that. So I don't have evidence, but the alarming part is that this might be happening inadvertently already. And the reason is that many of the platforms are now using what's called reinforcement learning. And this is a technique for machine learning that combines both prediction and behavior modification. Machine learning has roughly three kinds of methods. There's supervised learning, there's unsupervised learning, but in both of these, you usually collect passive data and build models. And then there's this third paradigm called reinforcement learning. And in reinforcement learning, you collect data and then interact and collect feedback. And then you can intervene and then again collect feedback. So this is a loop where you actually get user feedback and improve your algorithms and models as you go. Reinforcement learning combines two components. It has both experimentation interventions like A-B tests, if you've heard of those, right? Like clinical trials, if you want, and also predictive modeling, machine learning, predictive models, supervised learning. And by combining these two things, it is able to learn things that the other methods cannot learn on their own. A very famous kind of reinforcement learning scheme is called contextual multi-armed bandits, or MABs. And you can see here a little slide that I stole from online, where you can see that this is a recommendation system where the user is called the environment. Now, let me just tell you that many of these techniques come from, if you're thinking about learning chess or learning Go, right? These machines that learn how to beat people at it. So the machine is trying to learn the environment, maybe the chessboard and all the possible moves you can make here. But when we talk about online platforms, the environment is actually the user. And the agent or the AI here is trying to learn what users will do when you present them with a certain intervention. So you can see how the user has some features, and then the agent presents some kind of recommendation or an action, and then the user will do something, and that will reward the learning algorithm so that it learns certain things. Contextual means that it's also using information about the context, not just about the user himself, but a lot of other things around it as well. If you search online, you'll see that many of the platforms are using reinforcement learning and contextual multi-armed bandits. Here's a little slide that I stole again online from a Netflix presentation. And you can see that they're using contextual bandits here to improve their recommendation algorithms, that with this kind of contextual bandits, they can keep you a lot longer on their platform watching or viewing movies or other content than using other kinds of algorithms. Reinforcement learning are becoming even more autonomous, and now they're being embedded into them with deep learning. So you'll hear things called deep reinforcement learning, where now, because it's hard to model a user, an environment, right? A person is very kind of chaotic, but also predictable, but hard to model. So instead of that, they just basically put these huge deep learning models on top of it, and the deep learning model learns what to do and what treatments or interventions to offer. You can, if you search in some of the latest computer science conferences or papers, you'll see that some of these ideas have already been in practice either in research, but also you'll see several happening in practice. So here, there's an example here of a news recommendation system where they're using reinforcement learning to try and learn the user with deep reinforcement learning. So how does this whole story work with deep reinforcement learning? I don't know if you've had the chance to watch the movie, The Social Dilemma, but they actually, in a very pictorial and interesting story-like way, show you what reinforcement learning is. So I'm going to show you just like a few minutes from the movie that will really give you a feel of what the reinforcement is doing. And for those who haven't watched this or forgot what this is about, I'm going to show a little part where there's a son who's on his phone all the time, and his mom tells him that she's kind of bidding against him that he won't be able to leave his phone alone for, I can't remember how many hours or how many days. And he's really trying hard not to get onto his phone. But on the other hand, the social media is trying very hard to pull him back into the app. So let me just put this on. And at the beginning, you can hear someone from who used to work for Facebook talk about these kinds of algorithms.
There's only a handful of people at these companies, at Facebook and Twitter and other companies. There's only a few people who understand how those systems work. And even they don't necessarily fully understand what's going to happen with a particular piece of content. So as humans, we've almost lost control over these systems because they're controlling, you know, the information that we see. They're controlling us more than we're controlling them.
Cross-referencing them against comparables in this geographic zone is psychometric doppelgangers. There are 13,694 people behaving just like him in his region. What's trending with them? We need something actually good for a proper resurrection, given that the typical stuff isn't working. Not even that cute girl from school. My analysis shows that going political with extreme center content has a 62.3% chance of long-term engagement. That's not bad. It's not good enough to lead with. Okay, so we've tried notifying him about tagged photos, invitations, current events, even a direct message from Rebecca. But what about user 01265923010? And Ben loved all of her posts for months, like literally all of them, and then nothing. I calculate a 92.3% chance of resurrection with a notification about Anne.
Okay, so that was just, again, a depiction of what actually happens behind the scenes in a very pictorial way, but that is kind of how reinforcement learning is working. So now let's assume that a platform really is using this improved prediction strategy, whether it's knowingly or it's inadvertently. But if this is happening, then there's several questions that come up to mind. One question is, can this behavior modification actually mask poor predictions? Maybe the platform doesn't have very good predictive capability, but they're able to mask it. Another question, the customers, such as the advertisers, the marketers, whoever's buying these prediction products, can they infer the real predictive performance if the platform only reports to them the predictive performance after manipulation? Another question, many of these customers run these routine A/B tests on the platforms. Would they be able to detect that this scheme is going on? And the fourth question I'll ask is, what is the role of personalization in this whole strategy? So to answer these kinds of questions, I needed some kind of a way to represent the new scenario of prediction and manipulation. What I wanted to do was I wanted to derive a very famous and useful formula called the expected prediction error. And I wanted to derive it under manipulation. There's a very famous formula for expected prediction error without any manipulation, but I wanted to incorporate the manipulation into it. So I want to compute what's called the EPE. And this is basically the manipulated Y minus the Y hat and squared. So normally we don't have the word manipulated in there, and that's just the EPE. I wanted to add the manipulation into the story. The challenge was that although we have excellent notation for predictive relationships, in that world, there is no way to really convey a causal intervention. On the other hand, there's a whole world of causal inference in statistics and even now in computer science. But in that world, you can't really convey prediction easily. So there was no way I could put these two operations into the same language and use them to describe the scenario I was trying to talk about. Some people who have an econometric background said, hey, can't you use structural equation models? So I said, okay, well, let's try and write that out. But then you find out that that doesn't work out either because you don't really have this intervention working there. And actually, I'm not even trying to estimate a causal effect. So this is not really in the right direction either. So here's what I wanted to do. I wanted notation for prediction and manipulation. So I started from the standard predictive notation where there's no manipulation going on. And you see here, I have the Y conditional on X. I'm building this as some kind of a function F of X plus noise. And let's, for simplicity, assume that the noise has mean zero and variance sigma square. And once I estimate or train this F hat, I can generate predictions Y hat given X using this F hat function. The next step is I need to build in the manipulation. And this is where I use something very useful called the do operator that Judea Pearl coined. Judea Pearl is a famous computer science researcher, and he's done a lot of work on causality. And this do operator, what it does is whatever variable it has inside the do, it means that this variable here, you can actually intervene on it. So as opposed to, let's say, X here that does not have a do, X I can only see or I can only observe, but B I could actually intervene on. So that's why I have the do around that. And what I wanted to say here is that I want a function of both the manipulated behavior of the platform. So B is the platform behavior. And I want all the behavioral data about the user, which is X. That's what I see. And together with that, I'm going to manipulate their behavior. So the Y tilde here is simply the manipulated outcome given the platform manipulation and the user's profile. And you can see that I'm using a tilde to denote every time that there is a manipulation going on here. This is going to be a function G, and there's going to be a noise term epsilon that, again, I'm adding a tilde on top of that to show that it is affected by the manipulation. The function B here, this B here is a function of two things. It's a function of the prediction. So this is where the platform does have already the prediction from step one, and it has all the behavioral big data. And again, I'm assuming that epsilon tilde has a mean zero, and it has some variance that is different from what I had before. It doesn't have to be the same. And we're going to see that this is going to be a pretty interesting result here. So now that I have this Y tilde, I can actually start analyzing the expected prediction error, which is looking at this quantity here, the Y tilde, the manipulated Y, minus the prediction. And then I'm going to square it and take an expected value. Remember this, the picture I showed you before, this is where this do of B comes in, where the platform manipulates its behavior so that that manipulates the user's mental state. Remember that this is kind of a mediated sequence where the platform can only change its own behavior, and that will in turn change the user's mental state, which will lead to this Y tilde right there. Okay, so here's the classic expected prediction error formula. This is in almost every machine learning textbook, you'll find this. It's the basis for many useful results. And the expected prediction error is broken down into what's called the bias variance trade-off. So we see that the distance between the Y and the Y hat is a function of bias of the estimator, the F, the variance, and also some noise that there's nothing that I could do about it. I won't show you the whole derivation of the manipulated version, but I want to show you the result and show you how it differs from the standard formula. So I'm using a tilde on top to show that this is the manipulated EPE. And now you see here we have the Y hat tilde. And the derivation gives three pieces. The right-hand side is the same as the non-manipulated one. This is the variance. And this is basically, it means that your prediction error is affected by things like sample size. So the larger your sample is, usually your predictions will be better. The second part here in the middle is a little bit different. In addition to bias, it also has something called CATE, which is the conditional average treatment effect. This is the conditional average behavior modification magnitude. So for people with profile X, let's say people who spend this amount of time online and live in this location and whatever, with this profile X, this is going to be the average behavior modification magnitude. And you'll notice that this is what the platform's behavior modification is controlling. And notice that if this is equal exactly to minus bias, then you've actually canceled out the bias. In fact, it doesn't have to be exactly equal to minus bias. As long as it's smaller in magnitude and has the opposite sign than bias, then you're able to shrink this whole combined piece in the middle. And the third part, which is also very interesting, is this sigma tilde square, which tells you that if you have a very smart behavior modification strategy, you can actually shrink the variability and make people more homogeneous. I'm going to show you what these pieces mean in an example. So suppose that we have a food delivery service, and we want to predict drivers' risk scores, okay? And we have maybe a big platform that collects all the data about these drivers, and they can generate these risk scores that will be sold maybe to, I don't know, insurance companies, wherever it is. So I'm going to show you a very, very simple example here. So suppose that I only have X is a single variable, and that is the trip distance, and I'm trying to measure the risk. And suppose that the risk is how much time the driver is spending on the app while they're driving. And we have short distance distances, we have medium distances, and we have long distance trips. And suppose that the true function is this increasing function here, so that the longer the distance, the risk goes up, but it doesn't go up linearly, right? It goes up with this curve right here. The little circles here around here are different drivers. So we can see that even for drivers that are driving the same distance, there is some variability in risk. Some are more risky, some are less risky in terms of how much time they're spending on the app. So now let's suppose that I have my predicted fitted function. And suppose I don't know the real function. So my best guess is a linear function. And this is this linear line right here. My predictions here will be the red X's. So for a short distance, my prediction will be this red X right here in the middle. And we can see that, in fact, this prediction is too high for some drivers and too low for other drivers. But on average, it's kind of okay. But for the medium distances, you can see that my prediction is too high. This is what's called a negative bias. So in fact, my predictions are too high for most of the drivers. And for very long trips, my predictions are too low. I have a positive bias, so that the risk is actually much higher than my predictions. Now I can improve this with behavior modification. So here's one approach. Suppose that now I'm modifying the user's behaviors by doing all my different tricks that I have, by engaging them on the app or by changing the routes that they're driving or whatever you have at your disposal. And now you've noticed that I've pushed all the green dots in the middle here. I've pushed them up. So now I've made all these drivers riskier so that my prediction is now much better, right? On average, it's pretty good. And for the drivers who drive a long distance, I'm pushing them down. I'm making them less risky so that my predictions here look much better. So now my predictions look so much better than without the behavior modification. If I have an even smarter behavior modification, personalized strategy, I can do even better. Instead of just pushing the green dots up or down, right? Pushing the drivers up or down the same amount, I can actually squeeze them. So now you can see that the yellow points here are not only closer to the line, but they're also closer to each other. So now my predictions look even better. So these are examples of how I can use a manipulation to make my predictions look much better. So using all this derivation, I'm actually able to answer all these questions that I had before. So the first question was, can behavior modification mask poor predictions? And the answer is yes, because even if I don't predict very well, and let's say I have my bias is pretty bad, then I can use the KATE, which is the behavior modification, to mask this bias and make my predictions look really good. The second question was, can customers such as advertisers who buy these prediction products, can they infer the real predictive performance if I only give them the results after behavior modification? In other words, can they infer the EPE if I only give them the EPE tilde? And you'll notice that it's not very easy to do that because there are some terms in here that are extremely difficult to estimate unless you're the platform. And even the platform can't estimate some of these parts in here. So it's highly unlikely that an advertiser would be able to know what would have been the predictive accuracy had the platform not used this behavior modification. The third question was whether a customer who does routine A/B testing on the platform, would they be able to detect that something is fishy here? And the answer is no, because the A/B test that they're running is not for this specific manipulation. They don't know what manipulation the platform is running. They're running an A-B test on some effect that they're interested in testing. And the randomization that they're doing, the random assignment, is actually, it means that both groups are going to look exactly the same in terms of the platform's behavior modification. So when they compare groups A and B, they won't be able to see any difference in terms of that hidden behavior modification. And finally, the last question that I asked was, what is the role of personalization in this whole strategy? And it turns out that it has a dual role. The first role is that if you personalize your predictions and you predict much better, then you won't need to modify as much. Because remember, if your prediction is pretty good, you don't need to push people too much to get close to that prediction. But the other use of personalization is actually for personalizing the behavior modification. And what I mean there is that you can modify the content, of course, if it's ads or news or whatever it is, you can modify the content, but you can also modify things like the design. There are things called website morphing. So different people can see different designs based on what influences them the most. Or as I mentioned before, there are lots of what's called reinforcement types. How do you reward people to do different things? Sometimes you do social pressure, right? If you've ever tried to book hotels and tell you, oh, five people have already booked this kind of hotel recently, or time pressure or any kinds of rewards. Different people really react to things differently. So you can use personalization at the prediction stage, and that means less modification. And you can use personalization at the modification stage to create a better, safer prediction product in terms of having much less uncertainty. And I'll remind you again that this is what Stuart Russell wrote in his book, that the solution is to change the user's preferences so that they become more predictable. What I showed you here is how to formalize this into a statistical or machine learning formulation that allows investigation. Of course, if we're worried about the business customers, I'm sure we're all pretty worried about the users, the people, us who are being modified. And I'll just remind you that behavior modification in itself is not an evil thing. It was originally intended and designed for improving human life and improving society. It's been a little bit hijacked now. And this predict modify strategy that I described to you is very problematic because number one, it makes the users conform to their algorithmically determined destiny. We don't even know what's going on. We don't consent to any of this. And optimizing the platform's commercial interest can definitely be at odds with users' well-being and agency. I gave you a few examples where we're talking about risk scores. This is a risk kind of modeling is the classic example where you're really harming users. The customer probably doesn't even want to harm the users. So this is just something that's happening because of a platform's strategy. And again, the technical part here was that a statistical approach can really uncover many of the implications of using this kind of strategy. So to conclude, internet platforms now combine prediction and behavior modification. The approach, I was not able to find this in any statistics or machine learning papers, books, or whatever. And my suspicion is that it's not there because these two communities are really separate. The people who do prediction do prediction. The people who do behavior modification, but we don't typically do both of them. So I needed to come up with some kind of technical vocabulary to analyze this scenario. I chose to use Perl's do operator. There might be other options to do the same thing, but I found do to be very elegant and easy to explain. I also show in the paper that I'll share the link soon that the same vocabulary can be used to describe other kinds of strategies where you're combining predictions and manipulations, things like uplift modeling. I showed you a few imaginary scenarios. You can decide yourself whether they're imaginary or not. Very recently, I think a lot of things have been coming out of big companies. We know that there are a lot of implications for platform customers and users. If you've heard over the last few weeks or two, the Facebook files that the Wall Street Journal has investigated and put out are showing that there are a lot of things that are happening within the platforms that are not really acknowledged publicly. So whether it's just the reinforcement learning algorithms doing it on their own, or whether a rogue data scientist or management would make such a decision, I don't know which is happening, but very possible that these things are already happening right there. So I'm gonna stop right here and thank you very much.
Thanks to you, Galit. Thank you really very much. This was wonderful, very interesting. I think we can open two questions. I see there is a question by Jason. I don't know if you can actually speak, Jason.
Sure, yeah.
Hi.
So I was actually wondering, from the point of view of the customer, would they care about behavioral modification if they're being sold targets for advertising that behave the way that they want to? And I'm thinking particularly about the fictitious example of the voting. It seems like if they're being modified to vote for the candidate they're interested in, and then they're being sold as advertising targets, they might be quite happy.
Okay, that's a great question. So first of all, if you take that scenario, I never told you that political consulting firm, I never told you if they were for candidate A, or maybe actually they were against candidate A, or maybe they're just, you know, nonpartisan. True. So if they're for A, then maybe in that case, for the set of users that they tried this on, it was going in the direction that they wanted. But if they were anti-candidate A, then it would be going in the wrong direction. And if they were nonpartisan, of course, they would not want anybody affecting the results of the elections. So the answer is, that's one thing, that it depends on what the, if there's alignment between the goal of the customer and the platform. But let me take this a few steps further. The problem is that this is not generalizable, because if the platform is doing this to be able to sell the prediction products, and they're doing this for a certain amount of time so that they can, you know, sell their product to you and that you don't go to their competitors, nobody guarantees that they'll continue to use the same behavior modification later on. So if you're going to be still using the platform for advertising, for example, if it's an advertising example, and then later on they start modifying for other purposes, for other companies or whatever it is, you lost that behavior modification. You'll never see it. You don't even know what it was. The other thing that can happen is that some of these customers won't actually use the predictions on the platform, but they'll use them outside of the platform. If it's, let's say, a police or some kind of security agency, and they want predictions of risky people, they will take those predictions and then act on them outside of the platform. And since they don't have the same behavior modification capabilities outside of the platform, they're not able to replicate this result anymore. So this is a very non-generalizable kind of action that the platform is doing.
Really interesting. Thank you.
So we have another question. Robin, do you want to ask it directly?
Yeah, let's see if you can hear me. I was thinking, yes. First of all, if I want to hire somebody in a business school, how would we even find them? What conferences to go to, or what job services for young faculty? And then also, you said you were going to post a link to the paper?
Oh, okay. Sorry, that was my last click. There it is. So it's on archive right now, but it's actually, it's an invited paper that at some point will come out at the International Journal on Forecasting with some commentaries. But the paper is already there. You can see it at the top of my slide there.
Yes, I see it now. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, thank you for the reminder. What kind of researchers work in this field? Well, it's tricky. I can tell you that my work is really in information systems. So my background, you know, my PhD is in statistics before the days of data science that didn't exist. I've moved a lot into machine learning and data science, or whatever that's called today. But it really is, a lot of it has to do with information systems, because it's studying the platforms, right? And the customers of the platforms. And for me, it was also looking at the users and thinking about the prediction stuff. Within the information systems field, there is a big community of data scientists. So for example, the journal that I'm editor at, the Informs Journal of Data Science, is exactly catering to this kind of community of people in business schools who are data scientists. So I think that's the kind of, that's the closest I can point to. But I should also kind of, you know, put the disclaimer that I think my work is a little bit unusual. When I gave this talk to a bunch of different audiences, even within this community, they were looking at this and saying, "What? Wow, yeah." Because normally people don't think of behavior modification within the world of machine learning. This is really relatively new. The whole reinforcement learning business is relatively new. It's in AI, again, they've been doing this for self-driving cars, maybe, or winning chess or winning Go, but not for modifying users' behavior. So I think that's the interesting part that is kind of not really out there too much.
Thank you. So, and I would encourage any other question if there is.
There's a question on chat by Michael Hearn about the do.
Okay, so I see that. Okay, so Michael, do you want to?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me see. So is the do static or does it decay over time? If the behavior modification is permanent, then the modified behavior has now become the actual behavior. Okay, so this is a good point. I think what you're asking is if does the do, after you modify their behavior, do you predict it again and then modify it because you've actually already pushed them towards the final result? So what I'm talking about here is I call it two steps, but it can actually include some stuff in it. So the second step can include some loops in it, but the important part is that you start from just a prediction. And then the next step is you're going to modify towards that prediction. And you could do that in multiple steps and end up very, very close, but I still call that step two. Now, you're asking whether now you've made that user always very predictable. I don't know if that's what you're asking, but I think that's also related, is now you've made this person so predictable, is it going to be easy to predict them the next time around? I'm guessing on some things, yes, but there's so many different behaviors over time, and the apps do change, and there are new features, and there's new fads that come on all the time, that I think that it's not so easy to say, oh, now this user, I know exactly what they're going to do for every behavior that I give them, because just the space is too large and it keeps changing over time. So I think that's why you still have to keep learning again and again and again for every new behavior you might want to predict again.
Thank you. So I see there are some other comments in the chat. If anyone wants to read them loud.
Oh, hi. Mike Manti is related to Robin's first question, because I feel my research is closely related to today's talk. So I just provided a few comments, because my background is from the behavioral economics. So I'm more of a behavioral guy. And what I'm doing here is to try to explain and predict individual investors, basically in the financial market, how they will behave and how they are behaving based on their profile, like their previous behavior decisions. So I think there are some close connections. And I just want to add on, so apart from maybe information system researchers, people like me from the behavioral economics may also have interest and are doing similar things. Yeah. Very interesting talk, by the way.
Thank you.
Yes, indeed. So we are a little over time, but if anyone wants to ask, so take. Please.
Okay, so if you can. Hi, Galit, thanks a lot. Interesting talk. I just wanted to ask how strong you think is this phenomenon of modifying behavior? Because if it is super strong, then I don't even need to predict, right? I'll just force people to vote for whatever I need. If it is not very strong or zero or something, then there is not much to add on this. And, there is some recent research on, that all these nudges and so on, a lot of it doesn't work that strongly and oversold, et cetera. So basically, what's your feel right? Is it very strong? Is it not very strong? Will users become very smart to counteract this? Yeah, like this.
That's a great question. Look, this is, I can answer this in a professional way. I can answer this based on, what we're all experiencing ourselves when we're using these services. And what we're reading from the journalists who are investigating this. And we know that the behavior modification effects are actually very strong and very sneaky. We know that we have serious problems of addiction. We have, right, well, among kids, among adults, of course, right? Some of these things, I won't say all of them for everything, right? But I think that in some very fundamentally important behaviors that are affecting our human life, our social, our political lives in society, I think they're very, very strong. And the modification, you know, when you take people and you basically detox them, take them off, you read stories like this, you take people off of Facebook for 3 months, you pay them and right, you take them off. I think there was a paper in, where was it, in Science or Nature recently, where Stanford researchers paid people to just be off of Facebook, I think for 4 weeks or 8 weeks. And you can see that they completely change. And some of them won't even go back on it later on. So their whole behaviors and social behaviors, I think the effects are very strong. And the prediction and modification here are important. How it actually plays out, I don't know. You have to be inside a platform and dig into this, because I think most data scientists at the platform themselves, they won't even be looking for this. They won't even be thinking that this is what's going on. But that movie showed it in such a beautiful way, that that's kind of what's happening. And I don't know if you watch the movie, but what happens later is that kid goes right to his phone.
Thank you. We have two additional questions in the chat. One by Zeke Kao. Is there any empirical evidence for this phenomenon? And the other is, so then we close here, by Sumaya Deep. I hope I said the name correctly. As platforms, how might they put some check mechanism to such issues? So the first is about evidence, and the second is check mechanisms.
I personally do not have evidence that this is happening. But if both capabilities are there and a platform has these capabilities, I don't care if there's evidence that it's happening. I care that they have those capabilities and it is possible to happen, because that's like putting the two ingredients that blow up together in the same room. Did it happen or not? I don't know, but it's dangerous. So someone needs to regulate this. Someone needs to say you can't be able to both predict and be and manipulate behaviors. You're not, you know, impossible. Should not be able to do that. So I don't think it matters if it is happening or not. I don't think we need to wait for evidence for that, because as we know, it's very hard to get evidence from what really is going on behind the scenes. But I think that the capabilities should not be available in the same platform. And regarding how the platforms themselves might check the mechanisms, well, you know, the only way to do it is to turn it off and then see what happens without doing manipulation. But which platform is willing to turn off their behavior modification? I really doubt they'll be willing to do it. Just like I showed you the EPE and the EPE tilde, you can't infer one from the other. So the only way to do it is turn it off, see what happens, turn it back on. If you're willing to do that, probably you'll be able to see how much you modified users' behavior. Okay, and I see someone put
a... You want to look at the last suggestion from Simon French, our Ramsey medalist?
Yes, control theory, absolutely. Yes, you're right. And actually, reinforcement learning was developed kind of in parallel, or I'm not exactly sure which went before, but it comes from control theory in engineering and for computer science. And the whole control theory, like in thermostats, where you're trying to basically reach the right temperature by feedback control loops. Yes, absolutely. You're right on. And in fact, there's that much I can explain here, but yes, reinforcement learning is definitely also coming out of control theory. So yeah, it's all about control.
Thank you, Simon. Thanks to you all, really. Thanks to you all for being here. And a big thank for this wonderful, very interesting talk to Galit. Thank you very much, Professor Shmueli. And of course, so let's hear from each other soon. And our next meetings will be at the Informs conference. See you then. And thanks you again, Galit, for this wonderful webinar. Really, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And thank you also for the late time for you. Thank you very much.
No problem. Thanks for the great questions.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.